Father, we thank you for this house, Lord. We thank you for the opportunity that we have to be here. We thank you for the privilege that we have to come and to freely worship Jesus Christ. We lift up the name of Jesus in this place higher than any other name. It's not about a man. It's not about a woman. It's not about the old or the young, Lord. We come to this place to hear from you. And so today we ask in the name of Jesus, your Holy Spirit would speak to us, would be our counselor and our teacher, to lead us and to guide us and to remind us of your word, to show us your will and your desire for our lives as we walk out of this place, Lord, that we would leave equipped to be who and what you've called us to be, your church and a light to the world. And so, Father, we thank you that you would speak to your people today. Open our eyes to see, our ears to hear, Lord. We thank you that your word is sharper than any two-edged sword, and it divides on the inside of us, Lord, and it speaks right to us. And so, Lord, as we come with an open heart, Lord, we ask that you would speak to us today. We invite you, Holy Spirit, to speak to your people. Lord, we thank you for the churches across the Inland Empire that are hearing the gospel of Jesus Christ today. We ask that you would bless them, speak to them as you speak to us, Lord. We don't think of ourselves as better or anything like that, Lord. We know that we are co-laborers, brothers and sisters in the body of Christ, working together to build your kingdom for your glory. And so, Lord, we ask that you would speak to them, move in them, as we ask you would move in us, in our hearts, and in our campus today. And Lord, we give you the praise and the glory and the honor in Jesus' mighty name. We all said, amen. Amen. Well, if you've got your Bibles with me, go today to the book of Hebrews in the 11th chapter. We're going to resume now our line upon line, precept upon precept study in the book of Hebrews. We've taken a sidestep over the past month and a half or so, 2 months, to look at the vision of the church and the direction of where the church is going, as well as we took a couple of weeks there to talk about what God says about marriage in the church and our love song series. Did you guys get anything out of that love song series? I think it was a lot of fun. I really enjoyed Stefan, the VJ. Wasn't he fun? I mean, he's just an amazing guy. I love that. And every decade, he brought on that persona, like, perfectly. It was just great. And, 2000s, we're kind of, like, emotional in the 2000s. I was all quiet and, like, just text me your song request. I'm like, man, we got to get back into the communication face-to-face. But we had a great time. Now we're going to get back into the study of Hebrews line upon line, precept upon precept. And we're in probably, I think, one of the most exciting chapters in Hebrews, and that's Hebrews 11 chapter. So go with me to Hebrews chapter 11. We're going to look at verse number 24 to verse number 25 today, looking at the life of Moses. As we start, I just want to set it up by telling you a little bit about myself. You know, I never thought it would happen to me. Have you ever heard somebody say that? Man, I just never thought it would happen to me. I've heard about it. I've seen them. I have family member that has one, and I'm talking about a man chair. That chair, you know what I'm talking about? The one spot, the one place in the house that is the man chair. And I never thought I would have a man chair. And then we got this couch, and in this couch, there's this one spot in the couch that is my spot. It's my chair. You can tell that it is where Dad sits. That when I'm not there and the kids are sitting there or Stacy's sitting there, you know, it's open game. But as soon as Dad walks into the house, immediately, without words having had to been mentioned, the chair is surrendered and the remote control is held up. I like what they talked about in the marriage series, My Lord. My Lord, your throne and your scepter. The man chair, it's a dingy spot on the couch. There's some spots where, you know, I've had my snacks. It's my chips and guacamole. Can I get an amen for guacamole? Because we live in California. The Bible might say that Israel is the land flowing with milk and honey, but praise God, we got avocados. Amen. So I've got my proud avocado stains, and it's my man chair. You know, the pillow, it sags a little bit deeper than everywhere else on the couch. The back pillow kind of, it just doesn't fit anymore. It's a little bit faded, and it's exactly perfectly molded to my body. And it just so happens that it's 90 degrees on center to the television, and it is designed that way. You know, there are places on that couch I have never sat. Because it is my chair. Why is it my chair? Because I found, over sitting in it for a period of time, it is my comfortable chair. It is my space. It's the only place in the house I want to sit. If I'm going to sit somewhere, it's going to be there. And I think a lot like my chair, life is kind of like that. We want a comfortable life. Have you ever seen rain? I know, right? California, have we ever seen it? We don't know. El Nino, maybe it'll show up. Have you ever seen rain on a dry ground when the water starts to flow, water finds the path of least resistance, right? It doesn't want to run uphill. It doesn't want to go through a lot of turbulence. It's going to find whatever way it can to flow downward toward the ocean because of gravity taking it there. I think life in our lives oftentimes are like that. We want to kind of find the path of least resistance, right? I mean, I can say it like this. How many of you guys just want to live a life free of as much drama as you could get? No drama in my life. Amen. Amen. We want comfortable lives. As a matter of fact, we even call it the American dream, right? You want that little house with a white picket fence and 2.5 children, whatever a 0.5 child is, I don't even know. But that's the American dream. And we want that comfortable life. We want to, you know, we don't have to live paycheck to paycheck. We want a comfortable job and a comfortable income. And we just kind of want to just, you know, live. I don't want drama. I don't want challenges. I don't want anything in my life. And that desire, because it's a human desire, that desire oftentimes bleeds over to our relationship with God, where we want a comfortable relationship with Jesus Christ. You know, I'll come and I'll do my thing. I'm comfortable in my prayer life. I'm comfortable in letting the church kind of do all the ministry thing, and I just want to come and open my Bible once a week, and then, you know, next week I'll come and I'll open my Bible again, and I'm comfortable with that, and I'm good where I'm at. But the Bible has a lot to say about a comfortable life. As a matter of fact, the Bible, if you look at what the Bible really is, from Genesis to Revelation, the Bible is a narrative. It's a story. It's a story of a bunch of people like you and I. Have you ever read the Bible and look at Jesus and just think to yourself, how on earth am I ever going to be like that? Anybody ever wonder that? I wonder it all the time. It's free to, you're welcome to raise your hands on that one. The beautiful thing about it is that actually the Bible is full of hundreds of imperfect people who have made really stupid decisions in life and have done really bad things and made a lot of mistakes, but regardless of their imperfect life, it's full of, from Genesis to Revelation, a lot of imperfect people all pointing to the one perfect person, and that's Jesus. And in this narrative, we see over and over and over again what the Bible has to say about living a comfortable life, or more specifically, an uncomfortable life. And today what I want to talk to you about is the subject of uncomfortable faith. Uncomfortable faith, because we, like creatures of habit, we get into that area, we get into that zone, we get into that place where we become comfortable. I'm good here. I stepped out in faith that one time, and God came through. Amen. I did my requirement and I stepped out. I'm good now. And the Bible talks a lot about that. And specifically, as we look at Hebrews 11 chapter and the subject of faith in action, and now we begin to see the examples of faith in action, we're looking at the story of Moses. And if there's anything that we can take out of the story of Moses, is we know that Moses lived an uncomfortable life. I mean, think about it. From the very beginning, Pharaoh issued a decree because the Hebrews were growing too much in number and they were afraid that they might overrun Egypt to kill all the children in Egypt so that the Hebrews wouldn't grow. So right off the bat, Moses, his parents put him in a basket, covered it with tar, and floated him down the Nile River. And he was adopted by none other than Pharaoh's own daughter. And not only was he adopted by Pharaoh's own daughter, but then he was raised as the nurse by his family and his mom. Think about that for a moment. Identity issues, right? Your mama is your nurse, but your stepmama or your adopted mama is Pharaoh's daughter who issued your own death decree, and you don't look like everybody else. And then on top of that, after about 40 years, you make a decision, and then you go and live in the wilderness by yourself for 40 years. And then after that, you lead the children of Israel for 40 years back through the wilderness you thought you were delivered out of. Moses lived an uncomfortable life. You know this because you saw the movie. You're experts in the story of Moses, even though Hollywood probably didn't get it right at all, ever, right? I mean, but Charlton Heston and Christian Bale, and then there was Prince of Egypt too. We know the story of Moses. We see that Moses lived an uncomfortable life, but in the example of Moses, in the context of faith, I want to look at what the Bible says about Moses and how that applies to you and I today, and what God's word has for us today. In Hebrews 11 chapter, verse number 24, it says, by faith, because Hebrews chapter 11 is all about faith. About this time last year, we were talking about what faith is, how faith comes, and we learned about faith, and now we're looking at the examples of people putting faith into action, and it says right here, by faith, Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. He refused to be identified as an Egyptian. Look what the words are. It says, I want you to really pay close attention to the way it's written here, because in two sentences, the author of Hebrews, the Bible doesn't tell us who it is, but we know it's inspired by the Holy Spirit. The Bible gives us a very specific word. It says that Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. Look what it says in the next verse, verse number 25. It says, choosing rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. You see, this Bible, or this book, Hebrews, is written to Hebrew believers. So the Israelites, or the Jewish believers, you could say, this book, Hebrews, is written to them. In context, whenever you talk about Egypt to a Hebrew believer, Egypt represents something. Egypt represents bondage. It represents slavery. It represents all of the things that Israel was delivered from. And so here now, the word carefully written says that Moses refused to be identified as Pharaoh's son. Why? Because Moses did not want to be associated. Now we're looking at it from hindsight. Moses did not want to be associated with slavery. We look at bondage and slavery, and we have a new word for it in the New Testament church and in the 21st century. We call it sin. And the Bible says that sin shall no longer have dominion or rule over you. You're no longer slaves to sin, Paul the Apostle says. So just like Moses decided, he said, I'm no longer going to be associated with sin or with slavery or with bondage. You and I, we say in our hearts and our lives, I no longer want to be associated as a sinner any longer. But Moses made the conscientious choice to no longer be associated with Egypt. And Moses had to make a decision in his life. And it tells us here, it says that Moses chose. All right, it wasn't chosen for Moses. And we'll talk about this in greater detail in a little while. But it wasn't some uneducated guess where Moses was kind of like, this. It says that Moses, look how it says it. Look how it writes it. It says Moses chose to suffer affliction rather than enjoy the passing pleasures of sin. Think about that decision for a moment. Moses chose affliction over pleasure. Now, logically, with humanity wanting to seek a comfortable life, the logical choice for each and every one of us is pleasure. Moses was faced with a decision, a sensual decision or a spiritual decision. He had a decision either to follow what the senses say, pleasures, position, authority, a comfortable life, a life full of servants, a life when he could eat what he wanted to eat, when he wanted to eat it, a life where he could spend the money he wanted to spend, when he wanted to spend it, how he wanted to spend it. There was no questions, there was no limitations on him because of where he was. That was his sensual decision, or a spiritual decision to suffer affliction. Almost, you could say, an illogical decision. It didn't make any sense to the sensual mind. But Moses had to make a decision. And the Bible tells us, looking back at the story of Moses, that Moses made the decision to not be associated with Egypt and rather to be associated with the people of God. Moses had to make a decision. It's important for us to understand because every day, like Moses, you and I, we, every day, are faced with a decision in life, a choice. The pleasures of sin or the association with Jesus Christ. Every day, we have a decision. The Bible talks about this juxtaposition or these two sides of the coin, the sensual or the spiritual. As a matter of fact, in more biblical terms, you hear it like this, the flesh or faith. To choose, am I going to live? Am I going to decide based on flesh? Or am I going to decide or am I going to live based on faith? Every day, you have a decision, a choice to make. Are you going to give in to the decisions of the sensual, the flesh, or the decisions of the spiritual faith? Moses had a decision. And it's important for us to understand this concept that we have decisions to make every day, not just one great decision, an everyday decision. Why? Because the devil is going to do everything he can to get you to choose the sensual choice, the flesh. I mean, think about it. The Bible tells us that the devil is like a lion, walking about, roaring, seeking whom he may devour. Jesus said it like this: the thief doesn't come except to steal, to kill, and destroy. He hates you. As a matter of fact, he loathes you like the Grinch loathes the Who's. And he's going to do everything he can to present the sensual option as irresistible, as logical, as the one that makes sense. As a matter of fact, to choose anything but what the sensual choice is would be counterintuitive to your understanding. He's going to do everything he can to entice you and I to choose the flesh or the sensual decision. Why? Because he wants you and I to follow the path he himself took. And think about it like this. If he thought for a moment that Jesus himself would give in to the temptations of the flesh, how much less does he think of you and I? I mean, you think about that for a moment. He challenged the Son of God to temptation, thinking he might buy into it. You and I, we're easy pickings. It's like shooting fish in a barrel. And it's important for us to understand that we are faced with decisions every day because he is going to bring those decisions to our attention. And think about it like this. I mean, in Matthew, the fourth chapter, when he brought Jesus to temptation in Matthew, the fourth chapter, verse number 8, the Bible says that Jesus, he took Jesus up on a hill and he showed him all of the great civilizations and kingdoms of the world. So think about it. He didn't just take him up onto a hill and show him Jerusalem. He took him around the world in 80 days. Well, actually 40, right? Because that's how long he was in there, right? He took Jesus around the world. He showed him the great civilizations. He showed him the Roman Empire. He showed him the Egyptian Empire. He showed him the great empires in Africa. He showed him the great empires and the dynasty in the East and the Asians. He showed him the Mayans and the Incans of South America. He showed him the great kingdoms. And he says to Jesus these words. He says, Jesus, I will give you all of these great civilizations. All you got to do is bow down and worship me, and you can have it all. You see, he was trying to make the sensual, the flesh decision seem so irresistible. I mean, what person, what human in their right mind would turn down world leadership? I wouldn't. But Jesus didn't make the sensual decision. He made the spiritual decision, and he replies, and he says, get behind me, Satan, away with you. It's written, you shall worship the Lord your God with all your heart, and you only in him only shall you serve. You see, we're faced every day with a decision to choose the sensual or the spiritual, to choose association with the pleasures of sin or to choose the association with Jesus Christ. And it's important for us to understand this because the decisions that you make in life will determine your destiny. Let me drop that on you again. The decisions you make will determine your destiny. Think about that. Now, when you think about that, you're probably saying this, because I said this too. Wait a minute, Pastor Luke, but God determines my destiny. Amen? I like that. It's a good argument. Jeremiah 29:11. I mean, he says it, for I know the thoughts and the plans I have for you, says the Lord. Thoughts to succeed and to prosper you. God has a destiny for you. But you have been given the power of choice. Whether or not you will choose the destiny God has placed before you, or you will choose the destiny you choose for yourself, the passing pleasures of sin. God has given to you the power of choice. Therefore, the decisions you make will determine your destiny. It's pretty deep. Let me make it not so deep. Life is like a game show. There's this game show on TV called Deal or No Deal. Maybe you've seen it before. Howie Mandel comes out, his perfectly shaved head is nicely trimmed, whatever that is, right? Such a good host. And he comes out and he calls up some unsuspecting victim, I mean contestant in the game show. And they get to pick a suitcase. And there at the back of the stage is 24 models looking all good, pretty. And they're enticing, you know, doing the Vanna White thing. This is the suitcase you want to choose. And they choose a suitcase, not knowing what's in that suitcase. Maybe they chose it because that number 7 is their lucky number, or whatever it is. And they choose that suitcase. They make a decision. And the rest of the game is based on whether or not they made the right choice or not, right? And as the game goes on, the banker calls. If you've ever seen it, the banker, he's up high in the corner, and it's just this room, it's backlit, you only see his silhouette, and he's got a power suit and a power tie and a power haircut, and he makes a phone call, and he says, for your suitcase, I'll give you $500,000. And there's a decision in the game show. Are you going to make a deal with the banker, or are you going to have faith, you could say, that you've made the right choice? And as they go, you know, they open up the suitcases. It's exactly like that with life. You see, you and I, we chose a suitcase. And on our suitcase was labeled Jesus Christ, Son of God. And now every day, we've got the banker, the devil, in his little red backlit room with his power suit, power tie, power chair, and power little red horns, right? Trying to call and saying to you, hey, 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 I got a deal for you. All you have to do is give in to the pleasures of life, to have a comfortable life. I've got it all for you. Just give me your suitcase and I'll give you the deal. That's what life is like. But you see, the cool thing about it is that we know what's in our suitcase. We know what's in our suitcase because we chose it in faith. And every day, you're faced with a decision, and those decisions that you make will determine your destiny. As a matter of fact, the Bible tells us the destiny of the people who choose flesh over faith. In Romans, the 8th chapter, verse number 5, it says, to be carnally minded, or those who walk according to the flesh, set their minds according to the things of the flesh. You make sensual decisions, you're a sensual person. He says, those who walk according to the Spirit, their minds on the things of the Spirit. Now look at the destinies they choose. Verse number 6. For to be carnally minded, sensually flesh, is death.
Oh. Yeah.
But to be spiritually minded is life and peace. So when the devil calls and he says, I got an offer for your suitcase, we don't have anxiety. We don't have worry. We can respond like Jesus. Hey, away with you, Satan, because I got life. And I've got peace, but you're gonna have to make the decision every day. But Pastor Luke, I made that decision. I raised my hand in church. You're preaching to the choir. I'm saved. Yes. But that one decision is backed by many little ones. Why? I was reading an article. I've been researching, and I think it's just a fascinating thing about businesses and business organizations. And you know, I read a bunch of books about businesses and things, that principles that are successful. And one of the things that's so important within a business is the organization's culture. Peter Drucker, the father of modern marketing, said it like this, that culture will eat your organization's vision for breakfast, lunch, and dinner. And so the article was talking about a culture, and culture is this. A company might come and say, we have a vision to put out the best product in the world. But if the culture within the organization, the employees don't care, they just show up 9 to 5, they don't want to put any effort, they don't want to do anything else, the company doesn't want to invest in them, they doesn't want to grow, they don't want to continually change and continually modify, the culture will be stagnant, and the company will never attain its vision. And Forbes, in this article of the Forbes magazine, it said it like this. It said, culture is not defined by one choice, but rather culture is defined by millions of little interactions. You see, it's not a decision to say, I'm going to have a culture like this. Culture within an organization is millions of little interactions that back up the decision to have a good culture. Think about it like this. You made one big decision to follow Jesus. If you haven't done that, we'll help you out in a little bit. But you made or will make a decision to follow Jesus. But now the rest of your life is a million little interactions following through the one big decision that backs it up. Think about it like this. Let's simplify it. Habits. I was asking my wife, I said, babe, I need your help. What are my good habits? After an awkward moment of silence, we determined that there are very few, if any, good habits that I have. And so we decided, okay, how about this? How I brush my teeth. I brush my teeth, and I venture to say you probably do the same. I brush my teeth the same way every day. I squeeze from the toothpaste the same place every day, from the middle because it's the most efficient. And I start by brushing my teeth on the lower right, and I brush, And as I start brushing, I walk away from my bathroom sink, and I walk out of my bathroom, and I go and I lean on the doorway into my bedroom, and I just look and stare blankly as I move to the left side bottom. And instead of going from the left side bottom to the left side top, I move back over to the right side top, and I keep brushing. And about halfway through, when I get to the middle of my teeth, I leave my bedroom door, and I walk back into the bathroom, and by the time I make it to the sink, I have one of those toothbrushes that has a timer on it. By the time I make it to the sink, my timer perfectly ends. It's great. It's a wonderful process. But did you know when I learned to brush my teeth, I didn't make the decision. I didn't hold up my watch, imaginary, and say, I am going to brush my teeth like this. And I'm going to step 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I didn't make that decision. What did I do? I made a bunch of little interactions that eventually became a habit, and now I brush my teeth the same way, the same amount of time, without ever thinking about it. Those are the decisions you and I face every day. The little interactions. Are you going to choose the offer of pleasures of sin, or are you going to choose the association with Jesus Christ? Every day, your decisions will determine your destiny. So important for us to understand. And because we understand that our decisions determine our destiny, what do we do about it? This is the neat part of it, the really good part, right? Here it is. Because your decisions determine your destiny, choose to walk outside the comfort zone. And I put in parentheses, faith. Choose. Now, they say, Pastor Luke, this is so good. You know, I was thinking about, I want to do something a little bit bigger with my life, and I know I just want to get outside the comfort zone. This is not a self-help message. That's why I put faith in parentheses, because, man, that's a really good idea. One time I had a family member I was preaching on in Hebrews. It says, while you have today, use today, and my family member was like, man, that was such an amazing message. I'm going to learn how to play guitar now. I'm like, dude, that's not what I was talking about. So I'm not talking about walking out of your comfort zone, just try to be a better person. No, this is a faith decision. Why? That's why the word says choose to walk out of the comfort zone. Why? Because you have the choice every day. The pleasures of sin, comfort zone, or the association with Jesus Christ, uncomfortable faith. Moses lived an uncomfortable life with uncomfortable faith, but look at what Moses accomplished in his life. And if you look back at Hebrews, the 11th chapter, verse number 24, it says these words, by faith. Moses did not make a blind guess to what he was going to do. Moses didn't look to the Hebrews and to the Egyptians, and for the sake of illustration, you guys are Hebrews. Congratulations. You guys are Egyptians. So sorry. Moses didn't sit there in his palace and be like, eeny, meeny, miny, mo, catch a tiger by his toe. If he hollers, let him go. My mom told me to pick the very best one, and you are not going to be it. You, hey, guys, I'm going to be a heap. Moses didn't do that. It says by faith. By faith. Moses refused to be called the son of Pharaoh's daughter. You see, it's not a choice to say, I want to do something good with my life, and I'm just going to make a blind choice to step inside of my comfort zone. This is by stepping out in faith. You choose to live the spiritual and not the sensual decisions of life. Choose to operate, to walk in the spiritual and not in the sensual of life. The question is, what are you comfortable in? What is it that you're comfortable in? If you look at your life, and if you're honest and you challenge yourself and you look at the big red flags in your life waving at you right now, where are you comfortable? Maybe you're comfortable in your relationship or your marriage. You say, you know what? We've been this way for 35 years and we're going to die this way. Maybe it's time for you to step out of your comfort zone and treat your wife or your spouse in a way that you know you want to, but you just don't want to be uncomfortable about it. Think about it like this. I'll give you a real world example of myself. I am very bad at compliments. Long time ago, Pastor Jim told me after preaching a bunch of times, he says, man, Pastor, he didn't call me Pastor Luke, he says, Luke, you don't compliment very well. As a matter of fact, have you ever seen that movie Hancock with Will Smith, and they tell him, you know, you're PR, you're really a mean person, you need to tell. And he's in the scene the one time, the cops, and he's like, hey, good job. Good job. And they're like, shut up, go get the bad guy. Okay, just wanted you to know. I'm like that. My wife's like, babe, do I look good? I'm like, you look good. My comfort zone, right? I'm that introverted, intuitive, whatever. So to step out of the comfort zone and say, you know what, man? babe, I'm going to notice some details about you. And those shoes are just amazing. Your fashion sense is so ridiculous. You are on like an 11 right now. And I just wanted you to know that I noticed it. Maybe you're comfortable in the job. Maybe you sit through those meetings and you think to yourself, man, I know, I have an idea, I have a solution, but they don't want to hear it. You know, they don't. That's their job. I'm just here to just put my nose down. Maybe it's time to step out. Maybe you're comfortable in your finances. You know what? I got a good job. Everything's going well. Maybe it's time to start giving into the church. Start tithing like the Bible says. But that means, Pastor Luke, I'd give away the money that I have. Amen. Uncomfortable. Maybe you're comfortable in your Christianity. I'm happy where I'm at. I'm happy that I get to come to church and raise my hands, and then the next week I get to come to church and raise my hands, and next week and that's what I wanted to be. Maybe it's time to look at yourself and say, what am I comfortable in? And ask, God, what can I do to step out of that comfort zone? What can I do to get out of that comfy chair and do something great for the kingdom of God? Because the Bible tells us that Moses, by faith, chose to suffer affliction rather than the passing pleasures of sin, which is an illogical choice, but he did it because of faith. Why? Because choosing faith is walking in or choosing the unseen over the seen. It's choosing what you cannot see or what you do not know over what you can see or what you do know. As a matter of fact, Hebrews 11 chapter verse number 1 tells us, faith is the substance of things hoped for. It's the evidence of things not seen. And Moses chose to have the sensual, the spiritual decision to follow after God rather than to be associated with Egypt. You and I are faced with that decision every day. And it is so important for us to challenge ourselves to look at that and to say, I will not let myself be comfortable with my Christianity, to be comfortable in my relationship with God, to be comfortable in my prayers, to be comfortable in my faith, because I must every day choose to make the spiritual choice of life and peace and not buy into the bait of the pleasures of sin and comfortable lives. Because the Bible tells us, and you know the scripture, it says that we walk by faith, not by sight. And we talked about the Bible being a narrative of people from beginning to end. And the one thing that we can see in the narrative of people from beginning to end is this, that nobody in the Bible accomplished anything great for God inside of their comfort zone. Joseph had to go from being the son of Jacob, the favorite son of Jacob, to being a slave in Potiphar's house before he was ever the leader of Egypt. Gideon had to get out of the wine press he was hiding in order to defeat the Midianites. David had to put a sling or a rock in his sling and fling it at Goliath as he ran at him with no second option in order to beat the giant. Elijah had to challenge 400 prophets of Baal and soak his altar with water to call fire down from heaven in order to prove God's existence in a time where people were not believing. Paul the apostle had to get out of his comfort zone and endure the persecutions that he faced in order to be the leader and the writer of 2/3 of the New Testament. Jesus Christ, the Bible says, did not consider it robbery to be equal with God, yet he chose the position of a bondservant. He got out of his comfort zone to save humanity from their sins so we could make the choice every day to associate with sin or associate with Jesus Christ. You have the power in your hands to make the choice by faith to choose the spiritual walk, to step into the destiny, into the plans that God has, because the Bible says about you, the Bible says that through Jesus Christ, you are an overcomer. But the devil's going to present, the world's going to present, and circumstances are going to present all sorts of different logical choices that will give you one of two options. One, you'll say, I cannot make the right choice. I cannot defeat this. I cannot overcome. I cannot get beyond this. Or you'll say, I don't want to because I'm comfortable, because I like where I'm at, because it feels good. But God says, I want you to get out of it, and I'm going to give you everything I can to help you get out of it. But you've got to make the choice. Are you going to do it? And you and I, we have the decision. We have the power to walk in the destiny, in the plan that God has for each and every one of us. And that is by living an uncomfortable faith, by making the decision to step into the faith and to step out of our comfort zone in the spiritual and not walk in the sensual and the things that we can see. And when we do, like the people of the Bible who changed the world, that's when things begin to happen in our lives. Is in a life of uncomfortable faith. I've got a little video that explains everything I just talked about in about a minute because they can do it so much better than me. Check it out.
Jesus, I am so excited today. It's like I woke up and thought today is the day to get working for Jesus.
Kat, I'm so excited to find someone who's ready to take action and get things done.
Oh man, I am that girl.
Exactly.
Yeah.
I've got something perfect for you. So let's get started.
Okay.
What are you doing? Stand up. Remember, we were gonna take action.
Yeah, but this is where I always sit.
Right, but I need more than this.
Oh, I know what you're getting at. Okay, Jesus, how much do you want?
What?
$50, is that enough?
Oh, that's not what I meant.
Oh, all right, well, 100 then, you know? I mean, you drive a hard bargain. Okay, but you might not want to cash this till next Friday, you know what I'm saying?
Right.
There you go.
Okay, Kat, really, I do think it's great that you want to give, but I want you to mentor a younger woman.
Ooh, yeah, right. Well, Jesus, you know, I'm not really into, like, teaching people and stuff. I mean, I don't really get into that.
Okay, you know that woman at the office, Amy?
Yeah.
I want you to take her out to lunch. Tell her about me.
Well, Amy is different. I mean, like, really different, you know?
I know, but she needs to know about me.
And I can tell the people at the church to call her. I mean, they get paid to do things like that.
I want you to do that.
Jesus, I just don't feel comfortable doing that.
What are you doing? I am waiting for my coffee. Fighting off a panic.
No, Kat. The problem is, you're too comfortable.
A little light reading. Some lovely calendar choices. Would rather glue.
So think about it for a moment. What would the church... The body of Christ church, not the rock church, the body of Christ. The 2 billion people on earth that profess to follow Jesus. What would they accomplish if they just stepped out of their comfort zone? What could they do in the name of humanity if they just got a little bit uncomfortable in their faith? What could we hear in the Inland Empire, at the Rock Church and World Outreach Center, in your family, in your business, in your finances, in your faith, in your prayers, what could you accomplish if, like Moses, you chose to get out of that comfy chair and be uncomfortable for Jesus Christ? Because not only did he ask us to, he exemplified it by showing us exactly what he did. And I believe that God wants us to look at the flags waving in the wind of our lives saying, hey, you're comfortable. You're comfortable. You're comfortable. And address that little red flag warning and say, you know what? I'm going to get up and I'm going to do something about that. But it comes by making a choice. You have the power of your destiny in your own hands. And choose to live outside of the comfort zone in faith by walking by faith, not by sight. I know for me, I've been challenged in my job and what I do here and how I see that. I'm comfortable, and I've been taken out of my comfort zone. I'm very uncomfortable. I've been challenged in my prayer life. I realized and recognized that I was very comfortable in my prayers until I was challenged by another pastor's prayer a couple of weeks ago, and I was just thinking, man, I need to get out of that comfort zone. What areas of your life are you comfortable? I want to challenge you this week to go with God, spend some time and say, God, I'm comfortable here. What can I do to get out? God, I feel like I'm stuck in my lazy chair. Help me up. And let's see what God begins to do in your life, in my life, in this church, this city, this nation, this world. Because we, his people, made the choice that he himself made to be uncomfortable in our faith and to step out and choose that which we don't see over that which we do. And I think that's what God wants us to do. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you for your word. Lord, I thank you that even though it's good, it's challenging. Lord, I know that many of us today are thinking about that saying, that's talking to me and I'm just not so sure I want to do that. Lord, I thank you that you gave us the ultimate example of Jesus Christ to step out of your comfort zone. to live amongst us as a bondservant, the Bible says, to endure the shame and despising of the cross so that we could be free and be righteous in your eyes. Lord, I ask that you would give us the wisdom and the strength. Lord, I ask that you would give us the vision, give us the zeal and the purpose to step out of our comfort zone, to get out of that lazy chair of our area of our life, Lord, and to begin to pray like we mean it, to share the gospel of Jesus Christ like we mean it to those who need to hear, to get involved like we mean it, not just come and to be an observer, to be a participant. Lord, I pray that you would begin to speak to each and every one of us how we can step out of our comfort zones for your glory, not for us, but for your glory, so that when people see us, like your word says, they would see you and your goodness and in your glory and glorify you and not us. So, Lord, we believe that we could accomplish anything when you get the credit for it. So, Father, we make the commitment to step out of our comfort zone and to follow after you in uncomfortable faith. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, listen, before we leave today, I want to just take a quick moment. Don't get up. Don't leave. I'll let you out in just a minute. I promise. Won't take much more of your time. But I want to just give you a quick moment to examine your heart, to examine your life, to look into your life. We talked about red flags right now, waving in the wind. The Bible says that you ought to examine. You need to look at your life every once and again. And I want to ask you a question. And the question is this. If you were to die today, where would you go to? Where would you go? Would you go to heaven or would you go to hell? You see, how you answer that question has a lot to say about your position with God and where you stand with God. And so I want to go over your answers in this place today. You know, you might say, I think so, I hope so, I want to, I wish that if I died to go to heaven. You might say, well, you know what, my parents told me growing up that I was a Christian and Christians go to heaven. I was raised in church, I went to catechism or Sunday school classes. You might say to yourself, you know what, I was baptized or christened as a baby. I've got a cross or St. Christopher around my neck. You might say things like, you know what, I'm not a Buddhist or a Hindu or a Muslim or anything like that. That must mean that I'm a Christian and that I'm going to go to heaven. But did you know that nowhere in the Word of God does it say that you can think, that you can hope, that you can wish, or you can want? Did you know that nowhere does it say that because your parents told you, you were a Christian? Nowhere does it say that because you were baptized as a child or because you went to Sunday school or catechism classes, nowhere does it say that you've been given the title or label of Christian, that means you're going to get to heaven? The Bible says that there are going to be people that come to heaven and say, Lord, didn't we cast out demons in your name? And he's going to say, turn away from me, you workers of iniquity, I don't know you. You see, it's not about your title. It's not about the look on the outside. So often we think, well, you know what, Pastor Luke, I'm a spiritual person. I have a heightened sense of spirituality, and I understand that there's something greater at work than my own life, and I just kind of want to follow wherever it goes. You find your way, I'll find my way. Do good, be good, it's all good. But let me tell you something. The Word of God doesn't tell us that because you're a spiritual person that all classifications, all roads lead to heaven. As a matter of fact, the Bible says it very clearly that Jesus Christ is the way, the truth, and the life. And no one goes to the Father except through Him. And so today I want to give you the opportunity to accept that gift of salvation like the Bible calls it. Jesus says these words. He says that you must be born again to inherit the kingdom of God, to see it. You know, so often we think, well, if I'm a good person, I give to charitable organizations, you know, I even gave when the offering bucket came by, and good people go to heaven. The Bible tells us that according to God's righteousness, our good deeds are like filthy rags. You can never earn it. You can't buy it. You don't deserve entrance into heaven in a right standing with God. But despite all of that, you have a gift of salvation because Jesus died on a cross for you and for me. And in return, he wants us to accept his Son into our heart, into our life, to be the Lord and Savior of our lives. That's what born again means. Not what Hollywood, society's made it out to be, but to give a wholehearted commitment to God the Father through his Son, Jesus Christ. As a matter of fact, in the book of Revelation, Jesus is speaking to his church, not the world, not the general populace, his church. And he says, look it, I know your works, I know you. He says, I'm going to return, and when I return, I'd rather find that you're hot, I'd rather find that you're cold. He says, because if I find that you're lukewarm, he says, I'll vomit you from my mouth, I'll reject you, expel you from the kingdom of God. It's a shocking statement, almost so that you have to read it more than once just to say, did he really say that? And see, what Jesus was saying is that I'm giving you the plea, I'm begging you right now to stop relying on yourself, to stop relying on your talents, on your abilities, on your expectations or your thoughts, and start relying on me. Even in that statement, he says, I wish that you would buy from me gold and silver and robes of righteousness. And he says these words, behold, I stand at the door and I knock. And whoever opens the door, I'll come in and I'll dine with him and he with me and we'll be together. You see, God's not a manipulator. He's not a conniver. Some people like to say, well, if God wants me, he can have me. He did everything he could for you by sending Jesus Christ to die on a cross for you and for me, for our sin and our shame. And now the decision, the power is in our hands to choose whether or not we will accept or reject the offer of God, eternal life and salvation through Jesus Christ. The Bible says the gift of God is eternal salvation through Jesus Christ. It's a gift. And like any gift, you have the choice to accept that gift or to reject or return that gift. Your call. Today I want to give you that opportunity to accept that gift, to give you the call to respond to the invitation of Jesus Christ into your life. Jesus says these words. He says, nobody can come to the Father unless the Spirit draws him. And right now I believe, the Bible says it like this, it's the goodness of God that draws men to repentance. I believe right now in this place there are those of you that need to get right with God. And the Spirit of God is speaking to your heart right now. And I want to give you in just a moment the opportunity to accept the invitation that you are receiving in your heart by doing it like this. Jesus said these words. He said that if you confess him before men, he will confess you before his Father. He says, though, if you deny him, he will deny you. The decision is totally and wholly yours. And today, I want to give you that opportunity. In just a moment, I'm going to count to three. I'll go like this. I'll go one, two, and on the count of three, I'll go three. And I'll smack my hands together real loud, just like that. Bang! And when I smack my hands together, I'm going to give you the opportunity. I want you to do something real brave. I want you to do something real bold. I want you to pop your hand up. What you're doing by the raising of your hand is you're saying, you know what? I want to make a decision. I want to respond to the call of God. I want to give my heart. I want to give my life to Jesus Christ. I want to choose life with Jesus today. You see, I'm a man. I'll see your hand. I'll acknowledge it and put it right back down. I'm not here to embarrass you, to point you out, to single you out, to make fun of you. Here I am. My life's work is to build you in the things of God. And it starts by making that decision. Today, the very best decision you can make, the very best thing you can do is to choose life in Jesus Christ. Maybe you've been trying to fill up your life with meaning and relationship, from relationship to relationship, from finance to finance, with money, position, jobs, whatever it might be. But you find no matter how hard you try, there's an unquenchable thirst or desire to have more. Why? Because there's a hole on the inside of you that's designed and shaped by God to be filled only by Jesus Christ. And today, the invitation to accept life through him. It's not even so much what happens when you die. Jesus says, I have come that you would have life and that you would have it more abundantly. It's about choosing life today, now, through Jesus Christ. So I want to give you that opportunity today in just a moment when I count to three. If that's you, who should raise your hands? If you've never given him your heart, you've never given him your life, if that's you, in just a moment, get ready. If you're not sure, maybe you did this as a child or in the youth group or at a crusade once before, and you know, you never really followed through with it. You talked about those little interactions throughout the course of your life. You never really had many of those. Listen, if that's you in this place, don't walk out of here today without making sure that you're right with God. If you've been living lukewarm, what does that mean, lukewarm? A little bit in, a little bit out, occasional church attendance, token prayer, doing some of your own thing instead of God's thing. You're not running from God, but you're not running to God. You're kind of floating around, comfortable. If that's you in this place today, hey, this is the day for you to make the decision to choose the spiritual decision, the faith decision, to walk after the things of God and no longer be identified with sin and slavery and bondage, because it has no control over you through Jesus Christ, but it comes with a decision to follow Jesus. Wherever you're at in this auditorium, from the front row to the back row, from side to side, wherever you're at, you guys in the family rooms, I can see you through the windows. Hi. That's you in this place. In just a moment, when I count to three, you pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. You can put it right back down. You've had doctors and dentist appointments. Now, it's a divine appointment between you and God. And it's time for you to respond to the calling of Jesus Christ into your life and to accept the gift of salvation right here, right now. And it comes by making that choice. And we're going to do that together. I'm going to count to three. And when I do, if that's you, get ready. Pop your hand up. I'll see it. I'll acknowledge it. And put it right back down. And we'll go together. We'll go forward together from there. You ready? Here we go. I'm going to count. And that's you. Get ready. This is your moment. This is your time. This is the day of your salvation. Here we go. One, two, three. Let me see your hands in this place. One, two, three, four, five, six, seven, eight, nine. I see you right over there. 10, I got you back there in the back. 11, I saw you back over there. 12, I see you. 13, 14, 15, 16 in the family room. 17, I see you right there. 17 wise people, don't clap yet, we're not done. 17 wise people, if I didn't see your hand, all right, 18, I got you guys right over here. 18 wise people, anybody else? I didn't look over here yet, I got that one. 19, I see you right over there. 19 wise people, see them pointing over here. 20, I see you. 22, 20, 21, I skipped 21. 21, 21 wise people, anybody else in this place? Say amen. I wonder if I should. The Bible says that it's the gift of God. He's calling you right now. Respond to that invitation. 21 wise people, anybody else today? Anybody else today? Let's give the Lord a great big praise for 21 wise people. That's great. Amen. Well, 21 of you, and I believe 22, 23, 24, 25 of you in this place, and if not more, you may the decision to follow Jesus Christ, you're making a decision. Let me share with you reasoning, logic 101. Any decision without action is no decision at all. Why? Because nothing will change unless you do something about it. And now you've made the decision to follow Jesus. Now it's time to act upon that decision and to follow Jesus. And we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. We don't want you to go through it alone. We're going to pray with you. So if that's you in this place and you raise your hand, or maybe you didn't raise your hand, but you know you should have, you felt the call of God in your life, it's time for you to respond. In just a moment, we're all going to stand. As we do, my friend Elijah is going to sing a song. And as he sings, I want you to grab your coat, your sweater, your purse, a friend, a Bible. If you came with somebody, look to them and say, come on, will you go with me? Or if you brought somebody, look at them and say, you know what, hey, you know, do you want to go? I'll go with you. And get out of your seat, get out of your chair, get into the aisle and come meet me right here at this altar, because we're going to change destinies together right here, right now. So let's all stand together. If that's you in this place, come on, come and meet me right here, right now, wherever you're at, in the family rooms. You can come. The ushers will help you get your stuff. It's your time right now. That's you, come on.
Oh, and I am the child of God. Oh, I am the child of God.
Come on. They're still coming, come on, that's you. This is your moment. Praise God. Hey guys, you came. You are making the very best decision you possibly can make. I mean, think about it for a moment. You were choosing life, life today and life eternal with Jesus Christ. Somebody in your life needs to tell you something maybe nobody's ever told you before, and that's good job. Good job. Good job. You're doing it. Here's what I want to do. I want to introduce a friend of mine to you. See this guy waving at you? Remember him? He was just up here a couple minutes ago. Super cool guy. Tells it like it is, and I love him for that every minute of the day. He's going to do something. This is my buddy, Pastor Joel. He's going to take you guys right over there. Nothing weird goes on. You have survived me. I am as weird as it gets, all right? You made it through me, okay? He's going to take you guys right over there. Here's what he's going to do. He's going to lead you in a prayer. You don't get saved because you raise your hand. You get saved because you invite, because you accept, and you bring, and you give your life to Jesus Christ. And he's going to lead you in a prayer to do that. Second thing he's going to do is he's going to give you some free information, because after you do that, you're going to walk out of this place and say, what do I do now? We're going to point you in the right direction with some free information, very easy to read literature. Third thing he's going to do is he's going to invite you to come back and hang out with us. We want to get you connected with somebody here at church. We call them spiritual personal trainers. All right, it's like you go to the gym, you get a personal trainer that they help you to get strong at the gym. We're going to get you connected with a friend here at the church. They'll meet with you in our cafe. They'll buy you a cup of coffee or some nachos or a soda, whatever it might be, and sit down with you for a couple of weeks. No big long program, just to meet with a friend to teach you some things about the Word of God, to get you strong in the ways of God, so that you don't go back to the life that you're walking away from, but you go forward in everything God has for you for the rest of your days. So if you guys just turn to your left, my right, go right over there with my buddy, Pastor Joel.
Amen.